a pleasure for me. My name is Philippe Blanc. I'm a professor for MinParisTech. MinParisTech will introduce you. And I work for a research center named Center Observation, Impact and Energy. And it's my pleasure to present you about solar forecasting and smart grid. So you will see that it's not the same nature of the previous presentations. The previous presentation was focused on materials and technological materials, and here it's more about algorithm and prediction and things like that. Okay, so first, what is MinParisTech? MinParisTech is a school of engineers from more than 2,070 years. We have four locations: Paris, near the Quartier Latin, in Fontainebleau, Palaiseau, and Sophia Antipolis. And Sophia Antipolis is a place near Nice, and I'm working in Sophia Antipolis. So we have engineers, students, but also masters, specialized masters, and PhD, and postdoc also. And approximately, we have every year 400 students, which is quite small for a grande école. So we are also doing, in addition to pedagogical activities, we are doing research in many domains, going from the materials, energy, and I belong to the Department of Energy and Processing, geosciences, because it's the basic of the School of Mines, mathematics, applied mathematics, but also social sciences, and we are, as a researcher, approximately 700 researchers, not counting the PhD students. We have also a very specificity in the landscape of School of Engineers and University in France. We are strongly related with industries, so we are the first engineer school when we were looking to the contractual research activities related with industries. And this is done thanks to a very specific structure named Armin. So when you see someone from Armin or MinParisTech, it's normal because there is a symbiotic relationship between this association for research that makes the links with the industries and the School of Engineers and the academic part, MinParisTech. So in that framework, we have a strong collaboration with different institutions and companies. So we have common memorandum of understanding with Total, EDF, Air Liquide, Arkema, DLR, which is the German aerospace, but also some institutions like Mazen or Irizen, which are in the Morocco for the solar resource and the solar forecasting domain. So my research center, Observation, Impact and Energy, you can find the website here. So the name corresponds to the fact we try to use Earth observation, which is satellites, in-situ measurements, numerical models, everything that can give you some information about the state of the Earth and its atmosphere, and try to connect this Earth observation to the ability to have an assessment of the resource and the environmental impacts of renewable energy. So we are trying to characterize the renewable energy sources, which is more or less my main activities. And we are also focused on the environmental impacts of the energy sectors. And so we are doing more or less using, we are for example using, and it's the main subject of my talk today, we are using Earth observation data to do some solar resource assessments and forecasting. And we are doing also methodological research to have assessments of impacts of the use, the transportation, and the transformation of energy using the life cycle assessment, for example. And above two of these type of activities, we try to, so in our research activities, we are making a lot of scientific data, and we try to push the data towards the use. And we are making great effort on dissemination in an interoperable and standard way using web services. So our underlying scientific domain in the center is applied mathematics and data science, My background is image and signal processing, for example, but we are people on physics, meteorology, metrology, and environmental sciences. And for the dissemination part and web services, we have people involved in information communication technologies. It's also worth to say that we have also, related to this talk, another center named PERSE, Processes, Renewable Energies and Energy System. I do not belong to this research center, but the two centers belong to a group, the Department of Energy and Processes, and I'm the deputy head of this department. So this center of research is located also in Sofia Antipolis, and they are doing some research about material for energy, sustainable technology and processes. So many things about things that we have been presented yesterday and this morning. And also we have another group of research within this center, renewable energies and smart grids, which is very closely related to our topics. So inside this specific group led by George Kainotakis, maybe you know about him, you have his contacts. So the research axis of this group is renewable energy and smart grids, and it's the development of methods and tools to facilitate the integration of distributed generation and renewable energies into power system and electricity markets. So they are smart guys, and we are applied mathematics guys. So they are doing forecasting, but not, okay, wind power, solar power, electric demands, heat demands, dynamic line rating, the ability of a transmission line to be able to transmit the power despite the temperature, for example, the weather temperature, the electricity price, etc. So they are doing some forecasting. They are doing some multi-energy system hybrids, so very related to the talk we had, and smart grids. Okay, so my domain is more in the before the smart grid is about solar resource and assessments, and I will try to make the connection between to make a full talk about smart grids and solar forecasting. So, about the solar radiation at the top of atmosphere, TOA, and at the surface, you know that we get from the sun a gigantic amount of energy, you know, and the power is about 175 million gigawatts. So it's a very abstract figures, but you have to know, I'm sure that you know that we are getting in less than 1 hour an amount of energy that corresponds to the annual consumption of energy for the humankind in less 1 hour. So of course, a part of this energy do not reach the surface, and we have different phenomena involving that prevent from the solar irradiation, fortunately, because otherwise there is no life on the Earth. We have the atmosphere that protects us from the solar radiation. So a part of this solar radiation reaches the surface, but a part are diffused, retropropagated towards the space. And we have a budget on this. I don't want to go into details, but from the solar constant, which is approximately 1,377 watts per square meter, we get approximately no more than 70%. But you can see that this is a solar map of global horizontal irradiance at the surface. So it's a part of this energy coming from the sun arrives at eventually at the surface. And here you can see that even at the annual average, there is no homogeneous. There is a spatial variability of the solar resource at the surface, of course. And due to the fact that we are considering the horizontal irradiance, so the amount of energy you can get, for example, for a PV at horizontal plane, this amount of energy depends on the latitude. And you can see clearly that there is a latitude effect in addition to orographic effects, local meteorological effects, and you can compensate for this horizontal effect, latitude effect, by tilted the plan of the PV system, and to get the most from the sun, you can have a fixed panel, or you can have a sun tracking system panel. It's a very very large domain of interest to get the most from the solar radiation. So this is an example of the spatial variability we faced. So we have talked about the temporal variability, the intermittence. We talk about this, but of course this is also the same for the spatial domain. So this is an example of this type of variability. Here it's Carpentras, south of France. It's a place where there are some sun. And here you can have different years at a daily basis of the ongoing at the surface irradiance at horizontal plane. And you can see that you have the underlying maximum which corresponds to the clear sky. So if you have a clear sky, you can't get more than these values here. But of course, depending on the day, depending on the cloud coverage, you get more or less irradiation at the surface. And here you can see within a day the nature of the variability you can get due to the clouds, for example. And of course, and we will discuss about together after, there are different sources of variability in temporal and spatial basis. And of course, we are also in the solar resource assessment domain. We are interested in this spatial variability to do some maps, and to do some site screening to get the best location for developing PV. But also we are interested in the short-term variability for doing this forecasting for the smart grids, but also we are interested in the variability at the long term. Okay, we want to invest for 20 or 30 years for a PV system or solar concentrating solar system, and so we want to know what will be the amount of energy we can get for the 20 or the 30 next years. The main way to do that is to look at the historical part and say, we hope that we get the same for the future as we had for the past. So we are looking for database of historical data to make some statistical analysis for doing this solar resource assessment. But there is a problem. There is a problem. It's not the topics of this talk, but you have to know that there are some climate change, and this climate change may have some impacts on the solar resource. And we are interested in this type of things. And you can see, for example, from this paper, that we have indeed some trends. I don't like the term of trends, but long-term variability, interannual variability. And for example, for the China, we have a decrease since the 2000, a decrease of the solar radiation, maybe due to the air pollution. So it's difficult to know the variability at different scales. Of course, these scales, there is a joint variability that should be taken into account when we want to talk about forecasting. It is the jointed spatial and temporal smoothing effects. So just to illustrate you, I get a nice database in a 1 kilometer per 1 kilometer regions. And in it, we add 17 parameters, very nicely installed, nicely synchronized, nicely calibrated. And so we are interested in the variability we can get within a square of 1 kilometer per 1 kilometer, which corresponds to a pretty big PV system. So here you can see in color the variability you can get at 1 second basis. And of course, when you are... Sorry, where is my... You can see when it's clear sky, you do not have any differences between the sensors, but when you have some clouds, the clouds arrived on the PV plants, not at the same time, so you have some variability that induces spatial and temporal variabilities. So, and this is complex because when we want to do some forecasting, we have to take into account the smoothing effects that we will see afterwards. And this smoothing effect can be assessed thanks to a very specific way of describing this variability. And this is an example of variogram. So people maybe have heard about variogram. It is the differences, the average differences in terms of root mean square error between sensors, depending on the distance between sensors. So here you can see at 1 second basis, at 1 minute basis, at a 15 minute basis. And you can see that, for example, comparing 1 minute and 15 minutes basis, you get a higher variability at 1 minute basis. We understand that when you are looking averaging at 15 minutes, then you get a smoother field of solar radiation you can get from the sun. So this is very important to understand when you are doing solar forecasting. You have to consider the scales of variability in space and in time. You can do it. It is in fact the same, but it's maybe easier to understand. You can compare two signals from the sun, from the solar radiation, one second basis, but one average, one for one pyranometer and one average from all the 17 pyranometers. And you can see that you have this smoothing effect, and the red curves is much more smooth than each individual pyranometers. So, for example, if you want to monitor to do a forecasting of a large PV plant, taking into account one pyranometer at a point of this plant, this is not the same. The pyranometer is looking at very pinpoint place, whereas you have the footprints of the PV panel that should be taken into account. You have exactly the same at different scale, of course. This is an example of what we can get from satellites. So we are developing algorithm to assess the surface solar irradiance from satellites, and so you can get this type of no-casting solar radiation due to the variability due to the cloud, for example, here in France, every 15 minutes. And we have this type of data since 2004 at 15 minutes. And you can see that when you are averaging this data set, we get at 3 kilometers at the scales of, for example, for region here, department, you get smoother variability than what you can get at an individual one point at 3 kilometers per 3 kilometers. Okay, so this is very important. It is the same the speech about the spatial and temporal variability. So there is, to better understand this and to try to have a modelization on this variability, something very important you to know is, for example, the nice paper written by Hoff and Perez in 2010. It's not very recent, but very important paper, looking at the variability of a PV fleet, so a set of PV systems in a region, and at different time scales. We have to know that people who want to integrate the PV yield, the PV production into the grid, there are some restrictions about the variability at different time scales. So it's important to understand what is the relationship between this variability at these scales and the number of PV systems you have in a region to understand why you have this decrease of variability due to the distance. And there is a very nice, nicely organized way to do that. And I don't want to go into details, but here it is the curves of the relative variability you can get depending on the size of the PV fleet, so the different PV system you get in one direction, and the speed of the cloud in this direction. And depending on the size of this PV fleet and the speed of the cloud, you don't get the same averaging effects, and the variability, output variability of the PV system won't be the same. And you have some optimal points where the distance, the size of the PV fleet divided by the speed of the clouds and the temporal scales you want to assess, then you get an optimal point depending on the size of the PV fleet. So it is something that is very important to understand that there is an organization of the spatial and temporal variability, and it should be taken into account. Okay, this variability has, of course, a negative effect on the grid when you want to inject a large amount of this variable output. This should be in a solar domain, but also in wind, but I'm focused in solar resources, because it induces electric grid instability and problem of quality for the short-term variability, but also it has some problem with the energetic and balancing between different energetic sources. And we have also some problem with extreme meteorological events. And for example, for the solar radiation, one of the extreme we don't think about is the volcanic eruption. And this can go global. you can have a decrease of direct normal irradiance, which is the fuel of solar concentrating solar systems. And if you have one place in the world, a volcanic eruption, months after, you have a mass of dust in the atmosphere that decrease in a very significantly manner the amount of DNI you can get from the sun and converted by this system. So you have different type of variabilities and has some impact on the grid. So I'm not a specialist, but okay, this is the way we try to organize the mechanisms to integrate the renewable energy sources into the system. So you have the transmission system operator here who try to make at each time and different time scales a balance between the consumption and the production. And as we saw yesterday, this has an impact on the grid frequency. If you have the production larger than the demand, then the frequency is larger than the requested frequencies, which is in Europe 50 hertz. It's equal, then the frequency is equal to 50 hertz. But if the production is less than the demand, then you have decrease of the frequency. And we try to, at each time, to make a balance between the consumption and the production. Of course, the consumption has always been stochastic. It has its own variability. In France, the stochasticity of the production depends notably to the temperature, because we have a thermosensitivity of France, because we have a lot of houses that depends on the electricity to have the heat inside the building. So we have already the stochastic effect due to the consumption. What is new is among the different sources of energy, we have sources that are not compoundable and intermittent, wind and solar, for example, and in to less extent to the inflow hydraulic energy. So there are some mechanisms to play with, namely with the electricity market, to make some mechanism to regulate the integration of the renewable energy sources into the grid. So this is extracted from a PhD defense from Yves Marie Saint-Renan, which is working with us, fortunately. So the objective of the forecasting are clearly at different time scales. So we are interested in different time scales, intra-hourly for the ramp events, hour ahead for the load forecasting, day ahead for the energy market, for example, and medium term for the planning and the assets optimization. So, and of course, the very long term for the solar resource assessment and the bankable assessment for the banks to develop a project for the longer term. So very accurate solar forecasting methods are very important to pilot for the short term, to pilot in an optimal way energy storage, and we will have some examples, but also for the energy dispatching, for the TSO, for example, for trading on energy markets, and also for optimizing the solar energy production. We can have, you know, the PV system can be pilot in terms of tension, and you can have smart maximum power points using forecasting, for example. And for example, also, we are doing with a nice startup nearby here in X, named Optimum Tracker, and we are doing some works to do some smart tracking of the PV system depending on the solar forecasting. For the mechanism inside the integration, for the integration in the market, we need a day ahead forecast, and we said, so I'm a PV producer, so I am using a day ahead for forecast to say I will be able to sell this amount of energy tomorrow. So we need a forecast for that. The day is coming here. Then you have a part of congestion management to see if it's possible to get this amount of energy from different places depending on the energy distribution. And then it is possible in the market to use some intraday forecasting to adjust the prediction we made the day before. And when it is the time, then you have a problem or not of balancing. At the end of that, you have imbalance and you have a period of settlement of this imbalance because you have some penalties if you produce less or more than you said you will be. Okay, so this is the reason why solar forecasting is very important for PV producing also, not only on the grid part, but also on the PV production part. Something very interesting, maybe for the energy storage, it is a paper from Richard Perez again, the cost of mitigating short-term PV output variabilities. The idea is to use the storage, not for energy storage, but for buffer storage, and to smooth the PV production at different time scales. Okay, and the idea behind this this paper is, okay, depending on the time scale you want, so at minute basis, if you want to pilot the variability at 1 minute basis, or 5 minute basis, or 15 minute basis, and depending on the amount of variability you accept to have, then you need a certain amount of buffering to produce this level of smoothness of the PV output, okay? And this is interesting because you can see that depending on, not only depending on, maybe I can do it, no. Ah, yes. Here you have the amount of money, the cost of such a system per kilowatt peak of PV, depending on the request variability and the time scale of this variability, with or without forecast. And you can see that you can decrease the amount of buffering you need and the cost of the system if you are in addition to your system, make an electrochemical system, for example, forecasting. And so you can decrease significantly the amount of storage you need to do this job. Okay, this is the part of the way we can use the short term and the different time scale of forecasting for the smart grid. Okay, now I want to give you a very short overview of the techniques of solar forecasting we are doing. Okay, so first I want to say that solar forecasting is very difficult, especially if you want to predict the future. Okay, so we are Miss Irma and using some, you will see some fisheye cameras, some satellites, some in-situ measurement to try to predict the future. Okay, of course it's impossible to predict the future. And the idea in fact is to profit by the correlation, the relationship between the irradiation at one time with respect to the past and in one place with respect to the neighborhood. And this is there is no magic, of course, and we try to use this correlation, this spatial and temporal correlation, to do this forecasting. And for that, we need ways of observation to observe this solar radiation variability. So here you have a graph, a very schematic graph. Here it is the space scale. Here it is the time scale, and we have different sources of observation of solar radiation you can use to do the forecast. For the larger scale, in time and in space, you have the numerical weather models that help you to predict the weather. Okay, but you have to know that solar radiation is not very well predicted by numerical weather prediction models, because it depends on clouds, and clouds are very difficult to forecast. Okay, and and you have to know that there are some assimilation in this type of model. Temperature assimilation, wind speed assimilation, but no irradiance assimilation. So it's difficult. It's difficult to use, but it's mandatory to use if you want to predict the day after. We can't use in-situ measurements or satellites for the day after. Okay. So if you want to do some day after forecasting, you have to do in a way with numerical weather models. And at the opposite point, you have very specific measurements, which is the pyranometric measurements. And as I said, you have to take care about the smoothing effects between your PV plants and the in-situ measurement, which is very, very, very local. And in between, you have two sources of information that we are using to do the forecasting. We are using the geostationary meteorological satellites here. So, for example, Meteosat, giving us information, regular information at 3 kilometer resolution every 15 minutes with some errors, but we are using this. And we are interested in fisheye cameras, which is hemispherical images of the sky from points, and you can see the cloud coming. So there are some different sources of variability of solar radiation at intradaily values. You have, of course, the sun position. So you have this bell shape of the solar radiation that depends on the sun. So it's completely deterministic, of course. So there is no problem with that. You have something that can be forgotten because in Europe it's not so important compared to the clouds. You have the variability due to the transparency of the atmosphere. In many places, for example in Abu Dhabi, it is the main source of variability of the solar radiation because of dust. Okay? There is no clouds, almost no cloud in Abu Dhabi, but you have some variabilities. And this should be taken into account. And you have, of course, the variability due to the cloud. Here, it's an example of a cloud named MacClear that gives you some estimation at 3 hours basis, but it can be interpolated. Since 2004, you have here the temporal and spatial variability you can get with no clouds. Okay, the variability you get here, it's only due to the sun position. Here you can see the night and day variability, okay? But you can see also here a sort of variability here, spatial variability and temporal variability. Maybe, no, it's not working also here. So due to the water vapor, the ozone, the gaze, and the different sources of aerosol, black carbon, salt, many sorts of aerosol particles in the atmosphere that make some diffusion and absorption of the solar radiation and prevent the solar radiation to go to the ground. So this is something that is many times, even in scientific paper, forgotten in terms of variability for the solar forecasting, but we can do it. And we have sources of information that we can use to do this forecasting of the clear sky. Clear sky does not mean static, in fact. Okay. So, when you are doing some forecasting, something very important to take into account, it is the very basic forecasting, saying that it's a persistent forecasting, saying that, okay, the irradiance I will get in 10 minutes will be the irradiance I have now. So it's a persistence. And believe me, sometimes it's very difficult to be better than that. And, okay, it's important to understand that. It's not a real forecast, just a persistence. And when we are doing some forecasting, we always compare to this persistence, proving that we are better than this persistence. Okay, this is the level zero of forecasting. So if you want to do some practice with the solar system, with storage and solar PV production, something you can do is at least to do some persistence. You can do it by yourself and see what is going on with this type of algorithm. Sometimes it is completely sufficient. Okay, so I don't want to go into details on that, but there are some different ways to do the persistence. And normally, we are not saying that my irradiance in 10 minutes will be the irradiance now. In fact, we try to make an index, a clear sky index. Okay, so we remove the part of the clear sky that can be forecasted in different manner. And we said that the transparency of atmosphere in 10 minutes will be the one I have now. In that way, it does a very much better forecasting with a better consistency. So if you want to test this, try to use maybe the clear sky-based persistence model. You have the same in wind forecasting also, but you do not have this clear sky persistence. It's a wind speed persistence, and it's very difficult to be better than this persistence. Okay, we have also, once we have said that we want to do some forecasting, it is important to say what is the performance of this type of forecasting. So we have some different criteria, and the major one is the root mean square error and the mean absolute error. Okay, it's statistical. Okay, and you have the skill. Sometimes you will see in papers solar forecasting skill. In fact, it is the increase or decrease with respect to the persistence. So the skills in terms of RMSE is the 1 minus, the ratio between the RMSE you get from your algorithm and the RMSE you get with the persistence algorithm. So if this value is negative, then you are you are worse than the persistence. You can maybe change your job. Okay, so, and it is very important to understand that RMSE is a very good criteria, but it push the forecasting to be smooth. Because the error is counted with at the square value, so a small error will count a lot. So here it is an example of three types of forecasting with different source of and way to do the forecasting. And these three do not have the same shape. Sorry. Okay. You have a smooth one, you have a rapid one, and you one here is persistence. You are always in late. This is persistence. The three profiles have the same RMSE. So for people who are focused on RMSE, we are always show this type of figure saying, okay, it does not mean something. So we try to promote to have different ways of assessing the forecasting performances. I don't want to go into details, but more focus on the ability of the forecasting to forecast ROMs, for example. If you are interested in ROMs, rapid variability, quick variability of the solar radiation, and you want to forecast the time and the amplitude of this ROM, okay, the RMSE is not a good way to assess that. Okay, and we have developed and proposed new ways to assess this variability and the quality of the forecast. Okay, I don't want to do this type of description, but okay, as I said, the in fact is not it's not magical to do forecasting, and we try to get the correlation, and the way to get the correlation here is to get the temporal correlation. So maybe my transparency of atmosphere, including the clouds, my index, Kerskal index, for example, will depend in a linear way to the previous one. So it's a sort of persistence, but with a weight here, you can have here. And you can learn this weight by looking at historical data sets. So you try to learn about the correlation in time. This can be done with a linear regression, but you can also use artificial networks, deep learning, machine learning, whatever, random forests. So it's the place of data science, and to try to connect what we have in the past, the relationship between the future and the past. And once we have the model, we apply this model in an operational way. Okay. So, and this way it can be adapted, and you can have many, many papers about the way of applying Kalman filtering for people who are doing some signal processing. You have endless research about solar forecasting using this type of things. So here we are using only one value at one place, looking at the past. But you can also look, thanks to the satellites, you can look not only at one point looking at the past, but you can use the satellite looking at the past also, but also in space, and look at what is going on in space and in time. And so you can do some regression in space and in time to do the forecasting. So, and it makes nice forecasting, and we have made some publication on it. You can also look at it is very easy to understand, when you have two sequence of images from satellites, you can see the clouds moving, okay? So to detect what we call the cloud motion vector and say my cloud motion vector will be the same for the future. And you propagate the clouds for the future and make an assessment of the solar radiation at your point. Okay, so this is an example of RMSE you can get depending on the time horizon of forecast for 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours. And you can see that the persistence has a lower performance than the clone motion vector here. But sometimes here at the lower time horizon, then the persistence is better, could be better. You have the numerical weather prediction. I don't want to go into details. Yeah, there is a large bibliography on this subject, but you have to know that it's very smooth and it's not very good for solar radiation and it should be calibrated. So there are some ways to do a better job using numerical weather forecasts. Is for example to use mesoscale weather forecast. So going from global numerical weather model using, for example, the one provided by the European Center of Medium Scale Weather Forecast. It's a global forecast. You have also the global forecasting system from the US. So it gives you a synoptic view of what is going on in terms of weather, and you can apply the specific model on your place and downscale the situation and try to be better. It's difficult. But you can also use statistical learning. Okay, you have your prediction with WAF model or global one. Okay, you can look at the historical forecasts and try to make a correlation in terms of errors. And once you have this error, you can have a statistical learning. It is a work done by a PhD student, Adrien Verbois, for example, and try to understand the error you get comparing to your in-situ measurement or your PV production and make a better forecast out of the numerical weather prediction and the statistical learning. Okay. This is another sources of information you can use. It is the fisheye cameras. This is an example here. Okay, and so here you have the sun and you have clearly different layers of clouds. And you can see when the cloud will be will mask the sun or not. Okay. So at the time it was difficult to have because it was very expensive. This system here costs this system here cost let's say 15 years ago or 10 years ago 40,000 euros. So it's very expensive. Now you can do the job with security camera out of the shelf, used for the supermarket, for example, and you can use it to do some forecast, and it costs less than 1,000 euros. So we did an experiment in Almeria with the DLR, the German Aerospace, and other partners within the Horizon 2020 project, the NICAST, and we used different fisheye cameras. So it's Almeria in the south of Spain, and we use this camera here in four places. This is a square of 1 kilometer per 1 kilometer, let's say. So it's very cheap to have. And thanks to that, you can get some, so it's times 20 times the speed. You can use it to do a very short-term forecasting, okay? And the idea is to use not only one cameras, but different cameras. Why we are interested in having different cameras? Because here you have a camera and you have a view of the cloud, and you have a second camera at the same time, but in a different place. And from these two places, you can get the cloud height. And if you have the cloud height, then you can see where, you can know where will be the shadow of the clouds. And this is one of the results we get. At each time, we have the cloud heights, we have the cloud motion vector, and so we can do a very precise forecast thanks to these cameras for the short term. So here it is an example of the forecast. This is an example of forecast here of direct normal irradiance using the two camera here and looking at this place. Of course, we are not using the same place for doing the forecast and to test the forecast. And this is the result we get This is the persistence. We try to be better than that. And what we can see here, the in blue is what happens, and in red it was what we tried to forecast at the with a time horizon of 15 minutes. And you can see that here, we miss completely these ramps, and we forget it. Here we are using these fisheye cameras. It's not perfect, but at least here we have foreseen in a very precise way the amplitude and the time of the ramp. Of course, if you are interested, you can have many, many papers on this subject done by Pascal Kuhn from the German Aerospace, a PhD, in which I was a co-director. And I don't want to go in too much into details, but we tried also to have a common view, not only with two cameras, but one camera and a satellite. Can we do something just with one camera and one satellite? Okay, the satellite is not cheap, but it's already existing. So we tried to do that. And so it was a PhD from Loïc Valence. It was a thèse in conjunction between MinParisTech and EDF R&D. And the defense was on November. It was a very successful PhD. And the idea is to cross the line of sight from the satellite and from the camera, trying to be able to locate as much as possible the place of the clouds. We do not need to have two cameras, but one camera and satellites. And in addition, from the satellite, you can get also the cloud top height. So from the fisheye camera, you get the cloud bottom height. And from the satellite, you get the cloud top height. And by looking at the different views from satellite and from camera, you can get a 3D reconstruction of clouds. So it gives you this type of things, looking at the satellite and, cloud top tie, and here the fisheye cameras. You can get here the shape of the cloud, having a no-casting system of the shape of the cloud, and the shadow cast of these clouds. And from this, you can have a short-term forecasting in a very precise manner. So, as a conclusion, I hope that you understand that solar power forecasting and wind power forecasting is very crucial for large-scale penetration of PV or wind. There is a large number of Earth observation sources that you can use or combine. And it corresponds to a very large variety of scientific and technical domains. You have metrology, remote sensing, applied mathematics, data science, machine learning, etc. So if you are interested in doing a PhD on this subject, you are welcome. I want to say that I belong to a nice group from the International Energy Agency, just as presented by the previous, I don't know, Lucchese. Okay. He belongs to another task, another program. Here, the program is photovoltaic power system, and we are implied in the task 17, focused on solar resource for high penetration and large scale applications. And I am one of the leaders of this task, and we are dealing with solar resource, bankability also. Okay, not only the technical and scientific part, but can we ensure the data to go to the bankability of system to get money, and forecast. And since it's closely related to users, we are trying to do our best for the dissemination of the results of our task. Okay. And if you are interested, you can look at two nice books from Jan Kessel and from George Kaniotakis dealing with this subject. Thank you for your interest.